You will definitely need your popcorn for this one. Let's get into it. Hello guys, 3Bit here. Welcome to another episode of 3Bit Talks. So in our last video, we talked a bit about backwards compatibility, but this is a pretty interesting subject. So I believe there's more that can be brought to the table, especially as the consoles get closer to their release. So if you guys want to check out the last conversation, be sure to check out the link down below. And if you're interested in content like this, be sure to subscribe and click that notification bell to know when we upload newer videos. We're currently working on our podcast show that will be live every Friday starting next week, so be sure to check that out. So Sony and Microsoft has taken very different approaches to this next generation. Sony has taken the traditional approach in which you'd most likely have to upgrade your console for exclusive titles, while Microsoft seems to be creating an ecosystem for its devices. You can play Xbox Game Studio games on whatever device you want, whether that's on Xbox One, Series X, or PC. As long as you're playing games within their ecosystem, it's a win for them. So there are different approaches there, right? I do think we can all commend Microsoft's ambitious and uncommon approach for these new consoles. If you purchased a game on the Xbox, you can feel safe knowing that your library of games follows you. Older games don't become invalid because of newer technology, such as consoles. That is proven on the PC, where players are active on game titles as old as like 10 years, right? And I will continue to reiterate that till my bones explode, because Sony fans keep using that as a main point in their arguments for why we don't need backwards compatibility. If you sell your older console, like the Xbox One, for a newer one, like the Series X, then at least you still have your digital and physical games that are playable. You also get the automatic upgrades and resolution, frame rate, and even Microsoft's impressive HDR technology that allows HDR support for newer games, and it even apparently works for games as old as the original Xbox released back in 2001. By upgrading your console to the Series X, your older games will look even better. And the great thing is, this doesn't add any additional work for the developer themselves. So no waiting for a remaster or a re-release, which you will cash out for extra money. That is why Microsoft has announced a new feature on the Series X called Smart Delivery. This means if you buy a game on the Xbox One and you eventually buy your Series X, you'll automatically get the Series X version of that game for free. This, of course, is all up to the developer, so I hope gamers push how important the feature is so we don't have to buy a game twice. I know I bought like 3 different copies of GTA 5, so this is great news for me. As of the recording of this video, there is no similar announcement for the PlayStation 5, but we do know that there are some developers supporting this feature for Xbox, such as CD Projekt Red, the developers of the Witcher franchise, and the upcoming Cyberpunk 2077. But I really hope Sony takes some hints from this and they also put it on the PlayStation 5. This is Xbox's brand new technology for the Series X. You'll be able to run games from the Xbox One with increased fidelity running natively on its console, making both consoles, the PlayStation 5 and the Series X, as similar as ever to a PC. Microsoft's technology research is for sure a testament to the incredible work that the backwards compatibility team, they've been working on this technology for a while now. You're able to upgrade older games, it easily supports multiple versions of the game titles. So Sony's approach to backwards compatibility does come with a bit of a question mark, as well as a list of many other things we don't know about the console or its features. So we do know that the PlayStation 5 comes with some sort of boost mode for PlayStation 4 titles, as confirmed by Sony. So really want to hear a little bit more about that. Does that mean increased frame rate, or will sort of downgrade itself to the PlayStation 4 to match performance? So we will hopefully get more information on that soon. What is also different in Sony's approach is PlayStation 5 games will be exclusive to its system. So many fans of Sony see this as a good thing because they see older games as a negative. And I'll say this again, they say it holds back the system, but this isn't the case. In fact, it's kind of a false narrative that Sony lets people speak on for them, which they're pretty smart for, because Sony is showing their strengths and not their weaknesses, right? And it doesn't make any sense for them to compare their backwards compatibility program to Microsoft's very much ambitious approach, okay? But it should be common. That's the thing. It should be common, and fans need to speak up on this more, or Sony will most likely stay complacent. So, Sony, if you hear this, please add it. It would be great. Creating a game for the higher specification will be the new minimum for this generation. That means building the game for the Series X and PlayStation 5, while the Xbox One X and the PS4 Pro will probably get the weaker versions of the titles. The Xbox One X is already getting some of its major titles right now to 4K, so that will only be improved with higher and more stable resolutions. The specs in these machines are very impressive. So what will be improved is the SSD. Xbox is using the Velocity architecture. It will have better frame rate of up to 120 frames per second on the Series X. We already see this on, for example, Dirt 5 running on the Series X at 120 frames per second. So it'll be nice to see on even more titles. Many people seem to be doubting that the Series X can hit these benchmarks. They only have to look at the specs of what's in the machine, the RDNA 2, which isn't even released, and look what's already been announced. The developers of Gears 5 were able to use some of the most high settings for the game on the Series X. They did this while increasing the frame rate and even adding improvements to their rendering, making some areas look, in some cases, even better than the PC version that we have today. So, and think about this. The developers at the Coalition were able to do these enhancements to the game just by porting the game over to the Series X with only 2 weeks of work. Only 2 weeks. So games will no longer be bottlenecked by how powerful this console is, and I can't wait for other gamers to experience just how capable these systems are. But it is up to the developers to fully utilize this power. It is up to the developers. They have the tools now. It is up to them. Companies like Ubisoft stating that their game Assassin's Creed Valhalla will only maybe hit 30 frames per second it's unacceptable at this point for both consoles. The PlayStation 5 and the Series X are highly capable systems comparable to high-end gaming PCs. It is now up to the developers to utilize its power. We will most likely see developers utilize this even further in first-party titles, right, and games further into the generation. As most games in development have engines built around the Xbox One and PS4, but in 1 or 2 years, I can see that changing a little bit. These consoles are making it easier than ever to scale for in this generation, from older consoles to new. However, there are game titles exclusively coming to the Series X, like the game Scorn, where they talk about how they need newer hardware to push their game titles. The developer of Scorn mentions that his game is only possible on next-gen hardware for the Series X. I'd say that it's definitely possible, but it's all about your vision, right? What do you want the audience to specifically experience? Is high frame rate important to the feeling of the game? Is it going to be ruined if you don't have high frame rate? Are reflected mirrors using ray tracing technology a part of the game's feeling? Maybe the game is about mirrors, right? Then yes, you probably want people to only experience your game on next gen hardware, because this isn't possible currently on the Xbox One, or it is, but it won't look as good, right? For other titles, the scalability between the older consoles to newer consoles will more commonly be seen in frame rates and texture resolution. So the biggest difference you'll see between the old generation and the new generation will be the frame rate and the texture resolution. Graphics in this generation won't be obvious at first, right? It will most likely be something you'd have to experience. We are getting sharper visuals and higher frame rates this time around, and it does help if you have a 4K TV to take advantage of the performance upgrades. Unless you have an amazing screen, online videos are distorted in quality. You will definitely need to see these upcoming games for yourselves in 4K if you want to want the full experience. Otherwise, I don't see why you guys would upgrade to the newer consoles. This doesn't mean you won't see a jump in graphical fidelity, but it probably won't be as big of a leap from when we were limited to lower polygonal counts such as like the N64, right? It won't be that big of a leap, but there will be a leap, and you should definitely take full advantage of that by getting a good TV for yourself. The PS5 and the Series X are built to be very powerful consoles. They're both made to utilize and push its systems specifically for the games and features. If there is one anomaly, it would be the PC. Developers tend to build for the highest specification and then scale down to other systems like the consoles. However, this generation, I think we'll see a shift in the market. You see, PC has been where most gamers get the best experience when it comes to graphical fidelity. However, there is a downside to the PC, which we might see more in this generation compared to the previous ones. Not only is the PC bottlenecked by its own OS, Windows, which takes into account of other things running besides video games, the PC gaming market will need to adapt to consoles now, which is very interesting because developers use their development time to build for lower specifications on the PC. Developers have to make sure that their game works for a variety of different graphics cards and processors, and the most popular and affordable card on the market is the GTX 1060 graphics card, which is a relatively weak card compared to the 2080 Ti released by Nvidia. But this is a popular card, so developers use it to scale their games accordingly. This is where these next-gen consoles have the advantage. Not only do developers have the benefit of building their games for specific specifications, but both the Series X and the PlayStation 5 are using RDNA 2 technology, which isn't even out in the PC market. Essentially, the RDNA 2 cards make the consoles very efficient. The Series X alone is compared to one of the most powerful graphics cards on the market, the NVIDIA 2080 Ti. While the PS5 is a bit weaker in its CPU and GPU comparatively, I can see both of these consoles, regardless, hitting 60 frames per second as the new minimum for its games. The one major difference in the PS5 is its SSD technology. The SSD in the PlayStation 5 is amazing for open world games. Games will be able to load objects and instances immediately, rather than hide loading screens behind long elevator rides like in Mass Effect, or make gamers go through short corridors. However, there might be a little downside to the PlayStation 5's SSD technology, which I talked a bit about in my previous videos. The SSD is impressive, don't get me wrong, but because of the way the PlayStation 5 was built, the SSD's true potential will only be seen in PlayStation 5 exclusive games. That is because you would have to build your game from the ground up to utilize its technology. So developers have a very interesting decision here. Do I access and fully use this power, but run the risk of my game not being on other platforms? My guess is for most developers, the answer will be no. As even Sony exclusive titles like Horizon Zero Dawn, right, are making its way to PC. So without this boost of SSD speeds, the SSD can sort of be compared to the Series X, but the PlayStation 5 will most likely load games a few seconds faster in some instances. Sony wants to eliminate load times altogether if possible, and because of its SSD technology, there will be quicker load times and even faster download speeds. This doesn't make the PlayStation 5 more powerful than the Series X, so let me make that clear. The Series X definitely has the advantage when it comes to raw GPU and CPU power, which games use to show what happens on the screen graphically. Ray tracing is another difference between these two consoles. So what is ray tracing? Well, in short, it's basically a calculation of light bounces and reflectivity. So if you've ever been in a video game and you can't look at yourself in the mirror, ray tracing can accurately depict your character in that mirror in real time. There are no tricks here, just raw instances of accurate light and reflections. The Series X has a 52 computational units, or its other name, CUs. So what is that? Well, let's just say you need higher computational units for ray tracing. The higher the CU count, the easier it is to ray trace your game. So 52 is an impressive number. So I can see some games utilizing this to push their game to its limit. The PS5 has 32 CUs, so I don't see developers using ray tracing as much on the PlayStation 5, but only time will tell. There has been some instances where games like Battlefield would do partial ray tracing, only having a ray trace puddle as opposed to the whole environment, like the Minecraft ray tracing demo Microsoft showed off. Both consoles have 16 gigabytes of RAM. The more RAM you have, the easier it is for the system to run multiple things. So the consoles are pretty similar there. The last thing to compare probably is the games, right? Something Sony is known for is having the best game studios in the world, in my opinion, right? Microsoft purchased over 15 plus studios and counting from all over the world, but they definitely have something to prove this generation. Microsoft will have an event in July which showcases some of their major titles such as Hellblade 2, Halo Infinite, and many more from its other studios, while PlayStation will most likely have an event finally revealing their console later this month. So PlayStation is known for having amazing single player based experiences like Spider-Man, God of War, Infamous, Days Gone, while Xbox is known more for its online experiences like Gears of War and Halo, right? So both of these companies are making strides this generation, and while Microsoft has very impressive features and the consumer friendly backwards compatibility, the last check on their list will have to be the games. So Sony also needs to prove that they're not lacking in their feature department. They haven't announced much about forward compatibility for games, and they're currently having mixed messaging on their backwards compatibility. So we will see what happens with their console event about what is actually in the console besides the games. But the games are very important, so we will see, right? So this was part one of the comparison, and I hope you guys enjoyed the video. If you want to see part two, and you liked the video or you hated it, be sure to let us know in the comments down below. Don't forget to subscribe for more content from the Video Games HD. I'm 3Bit, signing off. Have a good one.